Gravity is the dominant force in the universe. Gravity causes the formation of planets, stars, and galaxies. It keeps the planets in orbit around the Sun, and it pulls us to the surface of the Earth. Occasionally, celestial bodies collide with the Earth that can start new geological processes and bring death and destruction that change the course of evolution of living things. Our solar system formed about 4.5 billion years ago from a dense cloud of interstellar gas and dust. The solid materials collided with each other and accreted to form gradually larger bodies in orbit around the central protostar that became our Sun. A planet is defined as a celestial body that is in orbit around the Sun and has sufficient mass to acquire a spherical shape and clear its orbit of other bodies by becoming gravitationally dominant such that there are no other bodies of comparable size other than its natural satellites under its gravitational influence. Approximately 50 million years after the formation of the Earth, the Moon was created from fragments of a collision between the Earth and another small planet about the size of Mars. This is what astronomers mean when they say that a planet clears the neighborhood around its orbit. The gravitationally dominant body becomes a planet after many such giant collisions. From about 4,100 to 3,800 million years ago, a large number of asteroids or comets collided with the early terrestrial planets and the Moon. The source of these impactors is not known, but they probably originated from debris of other collisions in the solar system. The scars of these impacts have been removed from the surface of the Earth by wind and water erosion and by plate tectonics, but they have been preserved on the Moon. The near side of the Moon is covered with large impact basins from which we can estimate the power of the collisions of the late heavy bombardment. The surface of the Earth must also have been impacted in a similar way. The dark areas of the Moon were thought to be seas by early astronomers, and they named them accordingly. Mare Imbrium, the Sea of Showers, has a diameter of 1,146 kilometers and an age of 3,900 million years. Apollo 15 landed on this site on July 30, 1971. Apollo 15 was the first mission to use a lunar rover. Mare Serenitatis, the Sea of Serenity, has a diameter of 674 kilometers and an age of 3,800 million years. Apollo 17 landed near the Sea of Serenity and examined the large mounds of bedrock that were displaced during the catastrophic meteor impact that formed the Serenitatis Basin. Apollo 17 was the last manned mission to the Moon. It was a 12-day mission that took place between the 7th and the 19th of December 1972. Mare Tranquillitatis, the Sea of Tranquility, has a diameter of 876 kilometers and an age of 3,800 million years. This was the site selected for the first moon landing by the Apollo 11 spacecraft because the surface is relatively flat. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin collected 21.5 kilograms of dirt and rock samples for return to Earth. Analysis of these samples showed that the Moon has the same geological composition as the Earth. This eliminated the hypothesis that the Moon had originated elsewhere in the solar system and then had been captured by the Earth. Mare Crisium, the Sea of Crisis, has a diameter of 556 kilometers and an age of 3,000 million years. These four impact basins were created during the time of the late heavy bombardment. Notice their huge sizes. They are all much bigger than any craters that we can find on the Earth today. Mare Imbrium, with a diameter of 1,146 kilometers, is thought to have been made by the collision of an asteroid with a diameter of 250 kilometers. That is about the size of the state of West Virginia. Tycho Crater is one of the most prominent craters on the Moon. It appears as a bright spot in the southern highlands with rays of bright material that stretch across much of the Moon's near side. Tycho's prominence is not due to its size. It has a diameter of 85 kilometers, and it is just one among thousands of similarly sized craters. What makes Tycho stand out is that it formed relatively recently, about 108 million years ago. The Planetary and Space Science Center of the University of New Brunswick maintains an Earth impact database that provides information about confirmed impact structures. The largest impact recorded here is the Bredefort structure with a diameter of 160 kilometers, although many sources described it as between 180 and 300 kilometers wide. The diameters of the large impacts are listed in this database with a lot of asterisks because they are the best estimates for the collapsed transient crater diameter from rim to rim, and there is considerable confusion in the literature regarding the definition of diameter. How many extraterrestrial impacts hit the oceans? We know of a few, but since three-fourths of the Earth is covered by water, there must have been many more impacts on the oceans than on land. This image of the Bredefort Dome in South Africa was taken from the NASA Space Shuttle in 1985. The Bredefort impact structure is the biggest confirmed crater on Earth, and it is roughly 2 billion years old. The original crater is thought to be up to 300 kilometers in diameter, but it has largely eroded away. The impact exposed some of the oldest rocks on the planet that range from 2.1 to 3.5 billion years in age. The Sudbury Crater is a large elliptical structure located in Ontario, Canada. The crater has a diameter of about 130 kilometers and it formed about 1.85 billion years ago. This area is known for its rich mineral deposits, particularly nickel and copper. The Bredefort and Sudbury impacts occurred during the Orosirian period of the Proterozoic Eon. The name Proterozoic is derived from the Greek proteros, earlier, and zoe, life. The Proterozoic Eon covers the time from the appearance of oxygen in Earth's atmosphere to just before the proliferation of complex multicellular life. These huge impacts happened at a time when the Earth was populated only by single-celled organisms. The Manicouagan Crater is located in Quebec, Canada. This image was taken from the Space Shuttle. The crater is a multiple-ring structure about 85 kilometers across, with an annular lake that is its most prominent feature. Scientists believe that the crater was made by the impact of an asteroid with a diameter of 5 kilometers about 215 million years ago. The Manicouagan impact happened during the Triassic period of the Mesozoic era. The impact would have killed many of the reptiles and dinosaurs that populated the Earth at that time. Every cataclysm changes the course of evolution. There is evidence that the first mammals arose about 10 million years after the Manicouagan impact. A rat-like mammal, Morganocodon, first appeared about 205 million years ago and lived from the late Triassic to the Middle Jurassic. The eruption of the Central Atlantic Large Igneous Province 201 million years ago caused an extinction event that killed 20% of all marine families. This event marks the end of the Triassic period and the start of the Jurassic period. The Chicxulub Crater is located on the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. It is known for being the impact site of the asteroid or comet that may have caused the mass extinction of the non-avian dinosaurs about 65 million years ago. The crater has a diameter of approximately 150 kilometers, and it is buried beneath several layers of sediment in the Gulf of Mexico. The outer ring of the Chicxulub Crater on the Yucatan Peninsula has a circular line of sinkholes or cenotes where the limestone has dissolved. For the Maya civilization, these bodies of water were sacred because they were the only source of fresh water in the middle of the jungle. Today, some of these cenotes have been made into tourist attractions where people can swim. The Chicxulub impact marks the transition between the Cretaceous period of the Mesozoic era and the Paleogene period of the Cenozoic era. A layer of iridium marks this boundary. Dinosaur fossils are abundant below this layer, but not above it. Some scientists do not think that the extraterrestrial impact was enough to cause the global extinction of the dinosaurs. The eruption of the Deccan Traps in India released large volumes of volcanic gases, particularly sulfur dioxide, that may have contributed to climate change. An average drop in temperature of about 2 degrees Celsius was recorded during this period. Scientists have speculated that the volcanic eruption of the Deccan Traps played a major role in the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction of the dinosaurs. The Chicxulub impact was just the final blow. A study from 2014 provides some information about the duration of the volcanic eruptions of the Deccan Traps. According to this paper, massive volcanic eruptions occurred just 250,000 years before the end of Cretaceous mass extinction. The main phase of the eruptions lasted over 750,000 years. The authors say that the relative contribution of these eruptions and of the Chicxulub impact in Mexico to the mass extinction remains unclear, but both provide potential kill mechanisms. There is evidence of another mass extinction in America 12,900 years ago at the onset of the Younger Dryas cooling event. Giant beasts that had inhabited North America for thousands of years and had survived the last glacial maximum disappeared in a geological instant. Gone were the mastodons, giant armadillos, and saber-toothed tigers, along with many other animals, weighing more than 45 kilograms or 100 pounds. The Clovis people who lived in America at this time also disappeared. For many years, scientists thought that human predation or the sudden onset of the Younger Dryas glacial weather could have caused the extinction, but in 2007, a publication by Richard Firestone and several co-authors proposed that the extinction event could have been caused by the impact of a comet, which also would have caused a global winter. The publication proposed that an extraterrestrial impact or airburst had occurred over the Great Lakes and that mineral microspherules found at the Younger Dryas boundary were the result of the impact. The extinctions and the cooling event were the result of the extraterrestrial impact. This proposal came to be called the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis. The proposal of such a large extraterrestrial impact in the very recent past was quickly rejected. A paper titled The Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis, a Requiem, claimed that none of the original impact signatures had been subsequently corroborated by independent tests or that they were non-reproducible. The Requiem paper claimed that the authors of the Younger Dryas paper had misreported or misinterpreted some data and that the recognized and expected impact markers of an extraterrestrial impact, such as an impact crater or shock quartz, were not found. The Requiem paper disregarded the Carolina Bays but did not mention the Nebraska rainwater basins or the precise elliptical geometry of these features and the fact that their major axes converge by the Great Lakes. An extraterrestrial impact on an ice sheet would not have left the markers usually associated with impacts on hard ground. The elliptical geomorphology of the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins suggests that these basins originated as inclined conical cavities, since they are conic sections. The glacier ice impact hypothesis, published in 2017, proposes that the Carolina Bays are the remodeled remains of inclined cavities made by the secondary impacts of glacier ice chunks ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. The kinetic energy of the ice boulders would have liquefied on consolidated soil and killed the megafauna within a radius of 1,500 kilometers from the Great Lakes. This LiDAR image of the Carolina Bays near Fayetteville, North Carolina, shows a landscape saturated with impact features that would have obliterated any creatures living in this region. The megafaunal extinctions were not restricted to North America. A study in southern Chile provides support for an extinction at the onset of the Younger Dryas cooling event. An impact in North America may not have been sufficient to cause an extinction in South America. It is likely that not one, but several extraterrestrial impacts caused a great catastrophe and devastation 12,800 years ago on North and South America. In North America, only the orientations of the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins provide a hint about the location of the extraterrestrial impact. In South America, the Iturralde crater in the Bolivian portion of the Amazon rainforest has been dated to about the time of the Younger Dryas, but at this time, the age is not precise enough to know for sure. The Iturralde crater is only 8 kilometers in diameter, and it is thought to have been created by the airburst of a non-impacting meteorite similar to the 1908 Tunguska event in Russia. There are still many loose ends. Nevertheless, we know for sure that an extraterrestrial impact happened 12,900 years ago because it left a widespread platinum layer similar to the iridium layer made by the Chicxulub impact. This piece of evidence cannot be disregarded as easily as the other evidence dismissed by the Requiem paper. North America also has a black mat that marks the boundary of the Younger Dryas. Below this black mat, megafauna fossils are abundant, but there are no megafauna fossils or evidence of Clovis people above this boundary. Here is something strange. Some genetic studies found a Y chromosome bottleneck starting at the Younger Dryas boundary and continuing for about 6,000 years after the Cataclysm. The authors of this paper proposed that the ratio of 17 females for each male during the most severe part of the bottleneck was due to cultural changes. But why will these changes occur in all regions of the world at the same time? This is something that still needs an explanation. Many artists depict extinction events with massive projectiles striking the Earth, but this is completely wrong. To put things in perspective, the Chicxulub asteroid that measured 10 kilometers in diameter was only one-tenth of the distance from the surface of the Earth to the Kármán line that denotes the end of the atmosphere. The Younger Dryas comet, with a diameter of 2 kilometers, was just a tiny speck compared to the size of the Earth. If it had hit solid ground, it would have made the crater only 12 to 15 kilometers in diameter, and the skill radius would have been less than 500 kilometers. But by hitting ice, which has one-third the density of rock, the icy ejecta went much farther and had a kill radius of about 1,500 kilometers. The Younger Dryas impactor would not have been visible after hitting the ice sheet. An observer in outer space would have seen an ejecta curtain of ice chunks and a quickly expanding vapor plume. Any water ejected above the atmosphere would have turned into ice crystals almost immediately. About 9 minutes after the extraterrestrial impact, dense clouds would have covered the United States from the Rocky Mountains to the East Coast, and there would have been no survivors under these clouds. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. I will continue to examine the mechanisms that made the Carolina Bays based on the principles of experimental physics. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.